strangely strange, but oddly normal.
Hi, my name's John Downs. That was the elephant in your conundrum. And welcome to another episode of On the Track.
Lorenzo the Lion Tamer Lawrence was one of the stars of Boomwell's famous travelling menagerie, but he gained most of his notoriety through his relationship with a special elephant called Maharaja. On April the 9th, 1872, an unusual auction took place in the Waverley Market in Edinburgh. The auctioneer at this sale was knocking down lions, tigers, elephants and numerous other exotic animals, while he disposed of the assets of Boomwell's Royal No. 1 Menagerie. In the audience at the sale was John Jennison, one of the owners of the Bellevue Zoological Gardens in Manchester. When the auction was over, he had spent £797.10 and was the owner of many animals, including a 7-year-old Asian elephant called Maharaja. The purchases were booked onto the 10:05 express train out of Waverley Station 2 days later. Lorenzo the Lion Tamer accompanied Maharaja to the station and was scheduled to travel with him in his last professional job. Maharaja was loaded into a horse box and the doors closed. Moments later, the front of the wagon was shattered and Maharaja's head was sticking out of the hole created. He then continued to trash the wagon. The situation was diffused when Lorenzo stepped in and unloaded Maharaja, returning the elephant to the platform where he once again resumed his mild-mannered and friendly demeanour. Lorenzo also solved the transportation problem by announcing that he would jolly well walk Maharaja to Manchester. Lorenzo and Maharaja set out for Manchester that very same day. They covered 20 miles on the first day, and kept up that pace for the following 8 days, arriving in Bolton, north of Manchester. From there they paced themselves so they would arrive at 2 p.m. on Saturday, April the 20th, the date advertised in the Manchester Guardian. The Jennison family were never backwards when it came to recognising a good opportunity to gather in a crowd, so all in all the trip from Edinburgh had taken 10 days and was a great publicity success. Along the road, legend has it, the travellers ran into a difficult tollgate operator who insisted on haggling over the toll for an elephant. Losing patience, says the story goes, Maharaja lifted up the gate and went on his way. The incident inspired at least 2 paintings and has been documented in a number of books. However, the event probably never happened. But the whole story of the journey from Edinburgh to Manchester is immortalised in a lovely little book by David Barnaby called The Elephant That Walked to Manchester. I first read it about 20 years ago and I've been terribly fond of it ever since. And back when I first read it, I made myself a promise that one of these days I'd go to Manchester Museum to pay my respects to the last mortal remains of Maharaja the Elephant in person. Well, it took me nearly 20 years. I've been to Manchester on several times in the meantime, but it always seemed to be in the middle of the night for a concert, or on a weekend when I was filming and I couldn't get away. But a few weeks ago, Karina and I were in Manchester to see Peter Gabriel, and so before the gig, we popped into the museum. And I finally got to pay my respects to Maharaja, the elephant who walked to Manchester. We'll be back in Manchester Museum later in the show, but the most important thing that's happened in the last few weeks is this. So, Richard, in 3 days' time, you're off to Tasmania to do something you've wanted to do for many years. Something you were talking about when I first met you. An expedition in search of our totem animal, the thylacine or Tasmanian wolf. What do you hope to achieve?
Well, I hope to interview some witnesses, I hope to find some sort of evidence, maybe dung, maybe tracks, if we're lucky. Ideally, I'd love to see and film a thylacine, but the chances of that happening are very slim. We're only over there for 2 weeks. I'm utterly convinced that they're still out there. It would be wonderful to see one, but I'm hoping that this is going to be the start of an ongoing project, rather like we've done with the orang pendek, where we've been back 5 times to gather evidence. I hope we can do this with the thylacine, not just on Tasmania, but on mainland Australia and in New Guinea as well.
So, tell me a bit about the structure of the expedition.
Well, the expedition has been planned mainly by our Australian contingent, Rebecca Lang and Mike Williams. They've had a lot of good luck with sponsorship, far more than we get. They've managed to get 2 four-wheel drives. There's a group from England coming, and we're going to meet up with the Aussies over in Tasmania, and then we're going to take the vehicles up into the wilds of Tasmania. Now, we're very flexible about where we go, so if there's any recent sightings, we'll be going to the place where the recent sightings are. So nothing's set in stone yet.
What have you been doing to prepare for the expedition?
Recently, Tony Healy, who's also going to be coming with us, a fine Australian cryptozoologist, sent me a CD of interviews with thylacine witnesses conducted by Ned Terry, and they're all from 1980 onwards until fairly recently. And there's over an hour's worth of interviews there, and these are very impressive, by seasoned bushmen, people who know what they're seeing, hunters, and that there's a number of sightings of adults with cubs. So it seems that the things are still out there and they're still breeding. I've always said that this is the cryptid that is most likely to exist, even more so than the orang pendek. And I'm utterly convinced of the existence of the orang pendek. I've seen its tracks, I've heard it calling. But this is the one I've always wanted to do. It's the one I've been planning to do for the last 20 years. And the one I came very close before to taking an expedition out there, and got ripped off by a television company who just used all my knowledge and my research and then sent somebody else. So something that I remain very bitter and very angry about. At last, I'm managing to get out there after all these years.
We wish Richard and the team all the best, and we will have the results of the expedition for you in the next month's episode. But now, a little closer to home, the mountains of Central Europe, where there have been a string of mystery animal sightings over the years. So now let's go to the beautiful Salzkammergut, and I'm sure I pronounced that wrong, region of Austria. Lake Traunsee is in the middle of this region. Its surface is approximately 24.5 square kilometres, and its maximum depth is 191 metres. It's a popular tourist spot with a medieval castle on its banks. The lake is surrounded by mountains, including the Traustein, and a number of other towns and villages surround the lake. However, there's something that Wikipedia will not tell you. Apparently, at least according to British tourist Matthew Townsend, it also has a monster. He emailed with this photograph. I have to admit that at first sight I wasn't at all impressed. It looks like a monstrous rubber duck. But he was polite, and when I telephoned him, he told me the story in his own words.
Well, basically, I was in Austria. My parents have a house out there, so I occasionally go out for skiing. And I took my 2-year-old daughter out there just for a bit of a holiday. And we're walking around one of the lakes, one of the mountains, and I happened to spot something just splashing around, really. So I got a bit closer, thought, that doesn't look like anything I've ever seen. Took a few photos with my camera, and then that's about it, really.
How long did you see it?
Well, from a distance, it was splashing around, and then took me about 30 seconds to a minute to get down from, like, the hill where I was to the actual part of the lake where I stood. And then I saw it for about 10, 15 seconds after that.
And you said in your letter to me that there's some folklore surrounding the lake?
There's some what, sorry?
There's some folklore, isn't there, about a creature supposed to be living there.
Yeah, sort of. When I got home, I was talking to my neighbour, Christoph, who I got friends with a couple of years ago, and I showed him the photo. And he said, oh yeah, that's such and such. I don't know what he said, it was in German or something. And I was like, well, what's that? And he says, oh, it's this dragon beast that steals naughty children or something like that.
And you've never heard of this thing before or since?
No, not really. I mean, I've showed the picture to a few people, but they all think I'm nuts.
I asked him if he could get any more information from me from his friend Christoph, and a few days later he wrote, firstly, the local name is either Wasserdrachen, which literally means water dragon, or Tatzelworm, which he translates as thigh worm. Apparently it's a bad omen to speak of the animal, and if someone does, it comes in the night to steal their children. It's also used to scare naughty children into being nice, claiming that the Tatzelworm will eat them if they're naughty. Christoph mentioned that these days most people have either forgotten about it or don't speak about it because of the bad omen associated with it, yet there are still quite a lot of sightings in different areas of Austria each year. He's apparently saw it when he was a child in the woods, but it was such a long time ago he couldn't provide any other details apart from it was effing huge, which isn't that helpful. As any cryptozoologist will know, the name Tatzelworm is more usually associated with the stumpy reptile and amphibian reported throughout the Alps, which has variously been identified as an unknown salamander, skink or snake. Sometimes it's reported as having two limbs, sometimes four, but I've never heard of it being described as a fairly conventional lake monster before. My gut feeling, as with anyone else I know who's seen the photograph, is that it's a hoax of some kind. But who is the hoaxer and who is the hoaxee? Matthew Townsend has always been helpful and polite during my dealings with him, and I have to say that in my opinion he's being entirely truthful about what he says he saw. So is someone trying to hoax him? If so, how and why? Or is my judgment of human nature woefully inadequate? Matthew tells me he'll be going back to Austria next summer and will try to find out some more, so watch this space. Now I think it's time to go back to Manchester Museum and the quest for the Manchester moth. It wasn't just to pay my respects to the skeleton of Maharaja, the elephant that walked to Manchester, that I wanted to go to Manchester Museum. I also wanted to see one of the only specimens in existence of a very, very singular creature. In 1829, an amateur insect collector named Robert Cribb collected a series of about 50 small yellow and brown moths from a rotting alder on Kersal Moor in Salford near Manchester. These turned out to be a previously unknown species of moth, but they were mistakenly attributed to a friend of Cribb's, the collector R. Wood, who'd asked the entomologist John Curtis to identify them. The moths were named by Curtis as Pancalia woodellia in Wood's honour. Curtis wrote, "The only specimen I've seen of this beautiful moth, which is larger than the others, is a female. It was taken on Kersal Moor the middle of last June by Mr. R. Wood of Manchester, to whom I have the pleasure of dedicating it, a most zealous and successful naturalist to whose liberality I'm indebted for many valuable insects." Enraged by this and by accusations of fraudulently passing off foreign moths as British, Cribb gave up collecting and left the rest of his collection with his landlady as security for a debt. This is where the stories differ. There are only three specimens left, one in London, one in Manchester University Museum, and one in the Australian Museum, Victoria. And the stories differ as to whether it was Cribb's pub landlady or the landlady of his lodgings. But either way, the result was the same. The debt was not paid on time, and when Cribb went back for the moths, which he'd already sold to another collector, his landlady had burnt them. Subsequent efforts by other collectors to find more of the moths were unsuccessful, and the three specimens left in existence are thought to be the only representatives of this extinct species. It was originally called the Manchester tinea, but it turned out not to belong to tineoidei, and actually to be a member of a very obscure genus called Euclimensia, with only three other species. The relationships of the Manchester tinea are now almost impossible to study in sufficient detail to determine if any separation is appropriate, but it does indicate that quite a distinct and peculiar lineage was lost with the extinction of this moth. It is one of my very fond hopes that this species will turn out to be a Lazarus species, a species which turns up again many hundred years after it was first thought to be extinct. One never knows. And it's one of my fond hopes that at some unspecified date in the future, somebody out moth trapping will find a little orange and brown moth in their cages and discover that the Manchester tinea, the Manchester moth, is not lost after all. However, I was disappointed to find that the Manchester moth specimen has degraded so badly that it is now not on public display. I was given the phone number of the entomologist in charge of it and told to give him a ring next time we're coming up to Manchester and he'd see what he could do to let me see it. That's a promise I have every intention of taking up. But this is not the only historical moth to be held in the museum collections. Here is a series of peppered moths showing the colour variations from the normal to the melanistic. An evolutionary adaptation shown by scientists including Professor Bernard Kettlewell to be industrial melanism. Evolution in action. When I was a schoolboy, the peppered moth was held up as one of the icons of evolution in action. But in recent years, doubt has been cast from several sources upon this. Jonathan Wells is one of a number of creationists who have criticised the use of peppered moth melanism as an example of evolution in action. In his book, Icons of Evolution, Wells alleges that peppered moth studies, and in particular Kettlewell's experiments, were erroneous. Similarly, in 2002, Judith Hooper repeatedly implied fraud and error in Kettlewell's experiments in her massively entertaining but ever so slightly dodgy book titled Of Moths and Men. However, despite some valid criticisms of these early experiments, there really has been no evidence of fraud, and subsequent experiments and observations have supported the initial evolutionary explanation of the phenomenon. Here, I believe, although I can't prove until I talk to the entomologist at the museum, is a series of Kettlewell's original moths, the moths that he bred and used in his experiments. So, like the Manchester moth, and like Maharaja's skeleton, here is a little bit of irreplaceable zoological history. But guess what? You won't be surprised to find out that there were several other things on display in the museum which were actually of quite serious interest to people who watch on the track. This particularly deformed red deer skull I found quite interesting. The skull is about 10,000 years old, and it was dug up in the 1890s during work for the Manchester Ship Canal. The fact that one of the antlers is deformed might well mean that the deer was in poor condition, undernourished, and died of the cold. And this is the skull of Old Billy. As far as we are aware, Old Billy was the longest-lived horse on record. He was verified to be 62 years old at his death. Born in England in 1760, he lived as a barge horse that pulled barges up and down canals. Old Billy was said to look like a big cob or shire horse. He was brown with a white blaze, as you can see here from his taxidermied head at Bedford Museum. On the 27th of November 1822, Billy died. His lithograph was published showing Old Billy with Henry Harrison, who had known the animal for 59 years. His skull is here in a place of honour in the Manchester Museum. Good to meet you, Billy. And here is something of genuine cryptozoological importance. A pair of huia. The huia was the largest species of New Zealand wattle bird, endemic to the North Island. Its extinction in the early 20th century had two primary causes. The first was rampant overhunting to procure huia skins from mounted specimens like these, which were in worldwide demand by museums and wealthy private collectors. Huia were also hunted to obtain their long striking tail feathers for locally fashionable hat decorations. The second major cause of extinction was the widespread deforestation of the lowlands of the North Island by European settlers to create pasture for agriculture. Most of these forests were ancient, ecologically complex primary forests, and huia were unable to survive in regenerating secondary forests. The last confirmed sighting of a huia was on the 28th of December 1907. Further credible sightings near Wellington were reported until 1922 and in Te Aruwaira National Park in the early 1960s. Our friend and colleague, Lars Thomas, believes that he saw one of these birds some years ago, whilst visiting North Island. Lars is a peerless naturalist, and I trust his testimony implicitly. If he said he saw huia, then he saw huia, and the creatures are not extinct, and there's a possibility that they may still make a comeback. I really hope so. Well, an iconic cryptozoological bird like this seems an appropriate place for me to introduce my lovely wife, Karina, and our regular monthly visit to the Watcher of the Skies.
I have always felt a curious affinity with this species of bird, probably because for 30 years I was a secretary, and this is a secretary bird, a highly specialised ground-dwelling bird of prey from an older family than the other Old World raptors. It is native to sub-Saharan Africa and is sadly non-migratory, so will never be a natural visitor to these shores. But I think you'd be surprised quite how many completely unexpected avian visitors Britain does have, and that's what this segment of On the Track is all about. Bernard Hoivermans himself said that cryptozoology wasn't the study of monsters, but the study of unexpected animals, and in the UK, what could be more unexpected than vultures, spoonbills and albatrosses? Yes, even the kings of the Southern Ocean have been seen in British waters. Two species of albatross have been recorded in the UK in recent years. Not all of our feathered visitors are quite so spectacular, but nearly every day there is something exciting to greet the Watcher of the Skies.
The Dorian shrike, otherwise known as the Isabelline shrike, was recorded at Pendeen, Cornwall from the 4th to the 7th of the month. Classed as scarce visitor to our shores, it lives in open woodland, scrub, savanna and farmland, where it feeds mainly on insects, especially beetles, but also will take small mammals, birds and reptiles. It breeds in southwestern Asia and winters in eastern Africa, the Middle East and India. It was first recorded here in 1950 on the Isle of May. A thick-billed warbler was found on the 4th of October at Geosetta on Shetland. This bird has a large breeding range in Siberia, Mongolia and northern China, and winters in Southeast Asia as far west as India. It's the fifth record in Britain, all on Shetland, with the first being on Fair Isle in 1955. It lives on reed bed and scrub and feeds mostly on insects that are taken from leaves or the stems of plants. An adult sora, a rail, was found on Tresco Scilly on the 9th and is the 16th record for Britain, the 6th for Scilly and the 2nd for Tresco. Classed as an accidental visitor, this bird breeds in North American shallow wetlands and winters in the southern United States through to northern South America. It feeds on aquatic invertebrates and the seeds of aquatic plants and lives on freshwater marshes. It was first recorded here in 1864 in Berkshire. A cackling goose was seen at Malin Head, Donegal on the 13th of the month. This newly recognised cackling goose is a smaller version of the Canada goose and breeds further northward and westward than does the latter, on coastal marshes, along tundra ponds and streams, and steep turf slopes above rocky shores. It is herbivorous and eats a variety of plants, especially grasses, sedges, grain and berries. It breeds in central and western Canada and Alaska and winters in the southern United States and Mexico. It is not yet officially recorded in Britain, but several small Canada geese have been reported, which may be of this species. On the 23rd of October, a Cape May warbler was seen at Balter Sound in Unst. The only previous record was of a male in Paisley in Clyde, Renfrewshire, in June 1977. It breeds across the northern United States in the boreal forest of Canada and winters in the West Indies. The species is named after Cape May, New Jersey, where Alexander Wilson collected the first type specimen. And somewhat eerily remarkable, Wilson's birthplace was actually Paisley in Clyde, his home being visible from the very trees in which Britain's first vagrant, Cape May warbler, was found singing. It feeds on insects, especially spruce budworms, during the breeding season, and nectar and insects in the winter. It has a unique tongue amongst warblers, whereby it is curled and semi-tubular and is used to collect nectar during the winter. On 28th of October, a mega-rare mourning dove was seen on the Isle of Rum Island. Despite being just the third record for Britain, after the last individual in 2007 on Northwest Western Isles, and the first in 1999, it lives in open forest and farmland and feeds on seeds, especially those of cereals. Once they've filled their crop, the record is 17,200 bluegrass seeds in a single crop. Don't know how somebody discovered that or why they would want to either. These birds can fly to a safe perch to digest the meal. They sometimes eat snails. Mourning doves eat roughly 12 to 20% of their body weight per day, or 71 calories on average, which I can survive on 71 calories. Its range encompasses North and Central America and is the most widespread and abundant game bird in North America. Every year, hunters harvest more than 20 million, but it remains one of the most abundant birds, with a US population estimated at 350 million. The oldest known mourning dove was a whopping 31 years and 4 months old. On the 27th of October, a ruby-crowned kinglet was recorded on Cape Clear Island in County Cork, and was the first for Britain and Ireland and the fourth for the Western Palearctic. This bird breeds in dry open coniferous and mixed forests and high elevations, and during migration and in winter they move to the lowlands. They eat tiny insects, spiders and eggs, especially those that are stuck to the undersides of leaves and twigs. In winter they will also eat some seeds, sap and berries. Metabolic studies on ruby-crowned kinglets suggest these tiny birds use only about 10 calories, technically kilocalories, per day. And that is just about it for this month. So now it's over to John for a regular look at new and rediscovered species.
An international team of biologists from Thailand, UK and the Lao People's Democratic Republic has described a new species of flying squirrel. The new species is named Biswamnoiopterus laoensis. The suggested common name is the Laotian giant flying squirrel. It's a large flying squirrel that weighs 1.8 kilograms and measures about 42 inches in total length. The body is about 18 inches long and the tail is 24 inches long. It's a remarkable discovery for science. It is a very rare species with large body size, explained Mr. Dawaphasan Samanakse, a master's student at the Prince of Songkla University in Thailand and lead author of a paper published in the journal Zoo Taxa. The specimen of the Laotian giant flying squirrel was incidentally found on display for sale at a bushmeat market in central Laos about a year ago. It's probable that the specimen was caught by a local hunter in either the Nam Kading National Biodiversity Conservation Area or the Cam Luang Limestone National Biodiversity Conservation Area. Experts have identified the world's first known species of venomous crustacean, a centipede-like creature that lives in underwater caves. The blind remipede liquefies its prey with a compound similar to that found in the rattlesnake's fangs. It lives in underwater caves of the Caribbean, Canary Islands and Western Australia, feeding on other crustaceans. The venom contains a complex cocktail of toxins, including enzymes and a paralyzing agent. The findings are detailed in the journal Molecular Biology and Evolution. The remipede, Spelionectes teutomensis, breaks down body tissues with its venom and then sucks out a liquid meal from its prey's exoskeleton. Co-author Dr. Ronald Jenner, a zoologist at London's Natural History Museum, said, "The unique insights from this study really help improve our understanding of the evolution of animal venoms." Bats of the genus Lontrophilia comprise neotropical nectar-feeding species characterized by elongated skulls with long muzzles and long extendable tongues. Most species are distributed from Peru northwards or along or adjacent to the Andes, with only three species occurring along the South American east coast. A new study focused on Longifilia bocomani and has revealed that Atlantic forest populations are distinct and new species, whose authors have named it Longifilia pirachi, in honour of the Brazilian bat researcher Adriano Lucio Pirachi. This new species occurs along 500 kilometres of Atlantic forest in southeastern Brazil, covering different habitat types including continental islands, evergreen successional forests and pioneer formations. Due to habitat requirements including climate and vegetation, the authors of the study expect new records of the Atlantic forest of southeast and northeastern Brazil, expanding the distribution area to about 1,500 square kilometres. Okay, ladies and gentlemen, that's about it for this episode. I hope you enjoyed it. Thanks very much for watching. For the next couple of months, we've got Mother staying with us, which is always lovely. And as you can see, it's not just Karina and I who enjoy having her around. The animals have all adopted her as their grandmother, and she can't sit down for more than 2 minutes without one of them plonking themselves on top of her. I'm very much looking forward to hearing about what the Australian expedition will have achieved, and we'll be telling you all about that next episode. I want to say a big thank you to everybody who has helped, particularly my lovely wife Karina, who as always not just put up with me, but is my late night camera person, and does all sorts of other things that I can't begin to tell you about. Without her, I really wouldn't be able to do any of this. A big thank you also to Richard Freeman, Graham Inglis, and everybody else who's helped. We're going to be having news soon of next year's Weird Weekend and some more expeditions reports coming up. So until then, be seeing you. La 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 la